It's a great pleasure to welcome Oscar Murillo this evening, but of course really to welcome Oscar and his colleagues at the Frequencies Foundation, particularly Clara Dublon and Marta Barina, for bringing this amazing project to Cardinal Pole School. Oscar, very, very simple first question. What is Frequencies?
Yeah, that's a very good question. I think when I want to try and through memory answer the question, but I think it's more true if I answer it conceptually or if I answer it in relation to the thinking processes connected to this long-term project. Frequencies, it's if we can look at this floor and see that it is obviously the map of the world repeated several times. It has this red line creating a square pattern. It is that line which indicates the equator. The line indicates the equator, which cuts through South America, Asia, the Pacific. It indicates the idea of cutting the world in half from a geographical perspective. And I see the equator line as an apolitical starting point, which allows a non kind of altered platform for anybody to have a discourse, or for the project to kind of engage with the North, engage with the West, engage with Asia, Africa, South America, and so on, without thinking about obvious political or politics in a kind of constructed or historical way. The fact that we have this archive here, over 40,000 canvases, I see it as a reference library. It is therefore in that reference library that any article, any essay, if we see this as in the context of books, can be then put together or articulated. That is, if you pick up canvases from, let's say, provinces in China, and then you go to, for example, Malaysia or Indonesia, and then you pick some other canvases from Harlem in New York and Singapore, and then you bring them together in an island like this, then that collision, that kind of friction, begins to speak and to be given a narrative of sorts is created. So in a way, Frequencies aims to allow for this diverse group of canvases that myself and Clara Dublanc and the team at the foundation and my family have put together over almost 10 years to be this free platform for engagement.
When you talk about the idea of a collision, you know, actually, you know, the atmosphere here is quite calm in a way. So, but you're interested in people and somehow this being mixed up to see what comes from different canvases being seen alongside each other?
Yeah, I mean, it was definitely important at this first instance, despite the fact that it's been 10 years of, I mean, 10 years just to round up the number of growing the archive, of traveling, of developing relationships with different schools around the world and people. I feel that Frequencies is still at its infancy, that it has a lot to, in terms of the archive growing. Perhaps we're coming to an end because in a way we could say that the pandemic is it kind of points to a natural indicator of concluding the way we were, you know, traveling, and also you know, education has changed and will continue to change, and we don't know how classrooms will go back, and this idea of sedimentation, of patina, might not be something that in the context of hygiene will be allowed anymore. So for us, it feels like it is a natural endpoint for us to begin to think about what is the second chapter, or what is the next chapter for the archive. We definitely think that the digital is going to be key. From the beginning, created a kind of promise to the schools and the institutions that the endeavor here was to create a network. And that is something that we'll begin now to work towards. And I am also interested in agitating, you know, what that collision could be, or what that provocative clash of bringing these canvases together could be for me as an artist. And I think the introduction of these paintings that I've made last year points towards that agitation in a way. As the archive was growing and we were taking the archive to different exhibitions, biennials or museum exhibitions, it had this feeling of it being a sort of reference, very much as we see it here. And I began to think, you know, with Clara, how can this be radicalized a little bit, and how can we create tension beyond the fact that just by bringing canvases together, there's a natural, very polite and silent, you know, mm-hmm. tension that takes place, and bringing them to the studio and stitching them, in a way, is a very physical, forced idea of you know, a collision, and this you know, frenetic gesture that is very much connected to my painting practice becomes another kind of another kind of break in that collaboration that was in a way put in place from the beginning when we went to schools and asked that kids, or offered, I think is the right word, offered institutions if we were allowed to put these canvases on the desks of children for 6 months, for there to be a natural engagement or not. Most of the kids, as we can see, were very eager to start with, and then time and the fact that you get used to that intimate space gave way to a more fluid or casual engagement. Sometimes I like to call it, you know, an unconscious engagement. And I wanted to then kind of, in this maybe provocative way, take some of those canvases and work with them in the studio.
Yeah, I mean, on one level, it could be seen as quite a, I mean, not just an agitation of the canvases from the schools, but something quite violent in a way.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I couldn't agree more. I think the violence happens in one level by erasure. You know, you're erasing your you know, in this aggressive way. You're canceling out, you know, a lot of that information. And in other ways, that all the information that is legible then kind of jumps at you.
So there's a sense in which, you know, if we look at that canvas there, for example, this is the series called Disrupted Frequencies. Are you then not really consciously thinking about what parts of the canvases are obscured or revealed? Are you leaving that to chance?
It's tough. It's a constant negotiation.
Because there's a very good little bit in that one there which said, there's a piece of writing which said, education is the most powerful weapon to change the world.
Yeah.
Which you must have seen, right?
I don't remember. You don't?
Well, it's there. And so I just wondered, okay, well, there's a big gap in that canvas. Is that deliberate, but you're saying it's not actually.
Well, it's hard. I think it's a constant negotiation. I think, you know, like when you're scanning the surface, when you when you bring this, in the act of preparing yourself for the act of painting, you know, so many things come up you and that, you know, you think, you know, how can I get rid of this?
Yeah, so you've got like the original acts of mark making by the by the students, you've got the act of stitching and sewing, then you've got your mark making.
Yeah.
So kind of three kind of layers of manual activity.
Yeah.
All coming together.
Yeah, and you know, and that's what in a way we're faced with right now. It's this this project, we can see it, it's so physical. It has been so physical. It's about, you know, I mean, a lot of these canvases, you know, feel like 19th century manuscripts. You know, they have this idea of time and, you know, coming from a totally different period, you know, fragility. They feel very precious. Also the fact that they've come from, you know, diverse number of places. Mm-hmm. So a lot of time, they feel like, you know, those kind of, again, 19th century ideas of receiving goods from a well that you've never visited. Mm-hmm. And yet you have complete, they're there for your kind of disposal. But yet, you know, we're entering also this moment of where technology more and more has become embedded in how we live and interact. I think if indeed we want this archive to be shared, you know, outside of, let's say, this privileged context of culture and the arts, then I feel like the digital is the only way.
So the digital is the next level of agitation.
Yeah.
If you like. So have you got any ideas? I mean, this is the first time that you've really brought the digital into the space of frequencies, is that right?
Yeah.
And what's that brought to you, this process of actually identifying consciously, framing it and identifying details? What's that process been like?
Well, the digital allowed for a more intimate engagement with a higher volume, like more canvases. I set up a professional photography studio in my studio for this endeavor to take place. We estimate that it's going to take 5 years for the entire archive to be digitized. And, you know, when I was preparing for this show in Colombia, you know, we're still in the pandemic, but in the height of isolation, of restrictions, I began to just go flick through these images, and it felt like second nature because we're so used to how we work with the phone or an iPad, and I began to frame these compositions that you see in the screen behind me, and behind this arena there are these small screens with these square compositions. So I began to zoom in onto some of the canvases and picked compositions that I found interesting.
Can I interrupt there? But it's quite, I think you used the word composition there, which I think, because you wouldn't say that anything else is really a composition. Mm. I mean, the canvases might involve elements of composition, but in there, and that's what I feel with these, they become a bit more like art.
Yeah.
Because you've made that conscious choice of, you know, focusing in on particular elements. Yeah.
Well, that's interesting because, you know, I think that going forward and to, again, to disrupt the frequency, again, beyond the paintings, which is something that, I'm very well versed at, you know, doing painting and again. But I think in the context of technology, and taking it, you know, how can it be taken beyond, and how can we interact with that and or interfere with it? I'm thinking about artificial intelligence as a component in which, if we see in this very, again, provocative way, if we see this, you know, hundreds and thousands of children that have participated as, you know, in the context of data entry, in the primitive sense of making a mark, the idea of drawing and downloading a mark from your brain to, you know, to your hand and so on. And then you take that, you know, very extreme kind of basic thing, and then you bring it on the other side of where we are right now, which is conversations about technology and artificial intelligence and machine and machine learning. And then you give these canvases to that, you know, situation. Then I think there's something interesting that could come out of that.
What could you imagine, what kind of program could you imagine a machine learning program might bring? What sort of algorithms might it
be? Well, my sister is a mathematician, so she'll know. I have no idea, but I think I'm just thinking about, you know, I feel like frequencies, when I started it and I thought of it, I was also thinking about democracy. I was thinking about the fact that at that time, almost 10 years ago, that in a way technology was still with us and you know, was already with us. We could say that, ironically, not just the West, but there were pockets, you know, around the world, kind of, we could call poor, you know, countries or countries with, you know, low resources. They were using technology like mobile phones because it was a very easy way to communicate if you were isolated. But indeed, there's the assumption that technology, as in its kind of, you know, purest, and we can see it in the context of the school, and you know, having just arrived from Colombia several weeks ago, you know, you really are in a advanced country, whatever we like to say or complain about.
A country with resources,
exactly.
And with, yeah, opportunities,
exactly.
Of some kind, yeah.
And so, but in the context of democracy, I said, well, at least the wherever you are, whether you're in the slums in Brazil or in a shanty town in the outskirts of Johannesburg, or whether you're in Singapore or Tokyo, that the school structure is we could assume that is vaguely the same. And that there will be a desk, and that kids will have something to write with, and that therefore that creates a kind of democracy across the board. And with that democracy, I want to start this project by offering this canvas on the desk, so that there is an immediate engagement, and the canvas becomes a recording device. Even if you don't write anything, the fact that you're just, you know, touching that desk on a daily basis, you're engaging with it. So that was something that I knew was the case as the starting point, you know, back then. And I feel that we're, you know, in this COVID situation, we will find ourselves, or we are in a totally different situation. And that, therefore, it marks a perfect moment to complete that idea and that experiment. And all this information or this material can now, you know, be kind of devoted to another phase.
I mean, it speaks, I always think there's a kind of, there's a restlessness in your work. Right, you don't, I mean, it's, you can see it in the energy of the canvases, the way you work in many different media and different contexts, but it seems like you don't want frequencies to settle into one thing. You want to keep kind of moving it on, creating new new context. I mean, and the digital, you're saying, is the next. I mean, the digital is the means for you to kind of unsettle frequencies, to make sure it doesn't settle down into a kind of stable archive somehow.
And I think also maybe fashion too. Not the idea of, you know, I mean, I really like the idea that it needs to kind of break away from like conventional ideas of what an archive is. Because, you know, those conventions are being kind of disrupted. Yeah. Like, not, I mean, forget about this, but just in the world, you know.
Why do you think that is?
I think it's just how, you know, I mean, just from a very basic point of view, I mean, I think just how we have come to exist, you know, and how we have come to live.
Do you think it's also because the archive in the traditional sense represents a kind of way of classifying and organizing knowledge, that, you know, you with a certain sort of hierarchy of power relations and whatever that you are never going to be comfortable with?
Maybe unconsciously.
Unconsciously.
Yeah, but that's, you know, that's an interesting point. I think you're absolutely right, because even though, you know, here we are with this very, you know, organized, you know, the foundation, you know, has done this incredible job of, you know, cataloging, organizing, you know, archiving, and in the context of the show, you know, we came together, we discussed, we, you know, and we have come to this, you know, installation, and I wish that I could just leave it here in this building, because then you can just very kind of audaciously, you know, begin to like steal it or something, you know, in this very public way. And then, as you said, I think you're totally right. You know, you in a way do frequencies, you know, you really kind of flex it, you know, in different directions.
So can we just explore a little bit another kind of important area of frequencies, which is, and I'm sort of conscious that frequencies arrives in London as this incredible reservoir of marks, let's say. And then, you know, I saw, like last weekend, the whole of the floor of Tate Modern was covered by
children
making marks. And then by coincidence, but, you know, exhibitions make their times. This coincides with Dubuffet's exhibition at the Barbican, which is, fundamentally about a kind of sort of rough and raw mark making, you know, even if, you know, then formed into something quite considered. And I wonder what so I suppose the first question is, you know, mark making is central to your practice. You're always making marks. Has that just come from when you were young, and that was something a daily activity for you? You needed to live by making marks. You needed to let that happen.
No, I think it's the most comfortable state in which I can exist. You know, not speaking too much, and, you know, keeping to myself. But I know that there is this huge amount of energy, you know, that I possess, and through destiny, it has been channeled through, you know, aesthetics and art, and I think also there is this, you know, the more I make marks now, I'm becoming very conscious of, I think, more. I think, you know, I remember a show I did in New York 2 years ago, and a friend who's a curator in New York, one of the institutions there, she said, you know, I was interested about the way you mark is that it does not engage with an academic. It has no relationship with an academic history, particularly in the US, particularly this idea of abstraction, and how there's been this kind of you know, looking at abstraction, you know, historically speaking, from, you know, a post-war moment, from a European context, and that you, that there is this kind of instinctiveness, and you know, and I had this podcast discussion last week, and we, you know, Ben Luke asked me if I could read, and what was it that I'm reading now, and I said I actually don't read, and I don't visit museums, and I think, you know, it's very important to protect that space, that, you know, and again, when I started to think about frequencies, I could not assume that I could become or untrain myself, you know, as in a way, as Picasso, you know, this idea of wanting to, or going through a process of unlearning to liberate yourself. And therefore frequencies is also born out of that kind of knowledge that I could not, or that I didn't have the time or the patience.
Are you saying that it is a process of unlearning for you, or that you didn't have to go through that because
that
you,
I protect myself against it,
right?
Because, you know, I mean, ironically, when I was in art school, I, you know, my all my studies was about the perils of education in this country. So, you know, the perils of education, you know, I started my education here in the mid 90s when New Labour came to power, and the erosion of public funding, the privatization of space, you know, all those different things were much more interesting than, you know, diving into books about academic, you know, painting or, you know, color field and all these different things. And I've always just protected, you know, the idea of mark making as my own kind of release, not to kind of connect it to history. Mm-hmm. You know, even though, you know, from the moment you put a work in an institution or a gallery, I mean, you know, you're kind of exposed to that. But
well, you know, consciously or not, there are always associations
course,
to be made. I remember we talked about Dieter Roth.
Absolutely.
And his tabletops, which...
Which also is another inspiration for frequencies. Yeah.
Probably, obviously these were Dieter Roth's own kind of like the markings of his own life, right?
No, but I mean, it was really an inspiration because I'm a huge fan of his work, and but I just didn't have the patience. You know, his practice is different in that, you know, he embodies time and space, and I don't. I want to, in a way, I want to frenetically disrupt it. You know, and I think all my work is about, you know, frenetically marking time and space. And I knew that, you know, I didn't have the patience to sit, to like have a desk, and, you know, to work on a day, like, you know, on a desk, and to kind of set it up in that way. And therefore, you know, things like the aeroplane drawings are kind of part of this idea that, you know, idle time, how can I make the most out of idle time in a long haul flight? And that, you know, drawing at the speed of 600 miles per hour, you know, is kind of amazing. And all those different ideas of mark making and drawing or painting, and again, it takes you back to these paintings in a way.
But as mark making can induce many different kind of moods, really.
Yeah.
So there's a certain kind of mark making which is meditative. Mm. You know, it's to kind of to quieten and to kind of still your consciousness. And your mark making is not like that. It's a mark making which is about constant movement. Mm. You know, things that just don't settle. Right? Even even in a disrupted frequency is obviously you've stopped making the marks, but somehow you look at them and you don't think it's, you know, it's so vividly alive.
Yeah. Well, that's so that I can be calm.
That's so you can be calm.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
We won't get into artist therapy with you.
Yeah. Well, I think it is. I mean, it's kind of, you know, I think art, I make work to be out of, you know, a desire to be, you know, just to kind of be centered, maybe.
Mm. Yeah. So I got just one more kind of question before we, just to prime you to get ready for your questions. You know, when you first imagined frequencies 10 years or so ago, you had a certain hunch in a way.
Yeah.
And what surprised you about it over the, you know, as it's become such a monumental epic undertaking? How different is it now from what you thought it might be 10 years ago?
Well, I mean, there are two things to that. So, like, seeing the first initial feedback, you know, when I first did it in Colombia in the school where I studied there, because you had access to young relationships that allowed you to do such a thing. And then Clara, you know, if it wasn't for Clara and her kind of energy and audacity to help, you know, frequencies be, and you know, and my sister and my parents, who also were very much involved in a lot of the implementations that took place around the world. I mean, if it wasn't for their kind of labor, you know, and in and then when they got involved very early on, I became very detached from it, you know, and you know, I would only see it really in this archival system that we designed in the studio. So it was very kind of always present, but very much, you know, our arm's length, and to see it here now, and to start thinking of its, you know, possibilities and potentials. It only really marks a beginning, also, despite the amount of time that it has been kind of growing, and therefore I'm not too kind of in awe of it. You know, I think it's, you know, it's again this idea that, you know, it's really something that, despite its physicality, really assists in your mind, because nobody's really going to go through 40,000 canvases, and therefore that idea of the archive is then a kind of ancient idea, or a kind of idea of the archive that doesn't longer apply. It's a little bit like the British Library. I don't read, therefore my relationship to a place like the British Library is not very familiar, but it's like a vault, you know. Like I feel like the with all this incredible amount of potential for information and knowledge, and I wonder how can that be more accessible, more public, more, like, you know, if indeed this has come from, you know, kids who are like sponges, you know, and are in this process of indoctrination and learning and gathering information in you know, in the context of architecture, which is the school, and then at home and with friends and social media, then I feel like it needs to go back to that place in order to do it justice.
Actually, one of the amazing things about the old reading room in the British Museum, you know, which was where the British Library, you know, you could,
yeah,
was that you were so, if you were privileged enough to be able to go and read books or study in there, that you just felt this incredible weight of knowledge around you. It was kind of constructed, yeah, like that. You were surrounded by books from, you know, in this circular building, sitting in desks.
Amazing.
In the middle. And there's a bit of this kind of weight that you've got, this sense of, this feeling of weight here.
Yeah.
Which is incredibly interesting just at the moment where, you know, as you've been saying, you know, the relationship between embodied and disembodied experiences, the kind of the physical and the digital, are becoming more and more kind of contested. You know, yeah, on one level, you know, everyone's talking about the need for the embodied, because we just haven't had that, and the physical archive, and the fact that you and Clara have set this up so that people can sift through it, they can in a way handle it or feel like they're handling it, is very important, but it runs counter to the kind of stronger drift which is away from, you know, the physical at the moment.
Yeah, I mean, and it's sad. I mean, I think it's also, you know, because I'm kind of sadly, you know, I'm not kind of doing this out of like an stubbornness against like convention, but I think if you know, if we can say that, you know, we just received some the canvases from Oman, for example, and if we say that kids from the age of 10 to 16 engaged in that project and that they completed that engagement, say 6 months ago, or, you know, let's say a year and a half ago because of the pandemic, then the youngest kid in that endeavor and in that kind of, let's say, in this network of individuals is 12 or 13, then that's the youngest collaborator. When he or she becomes an adult, you know, it's you know, let's say, to round it up, 10 years from now. And I think I have responsibility towards that. And maybe gauging or guessing or betting on how can that communication be. And it's very unlikely that it's going to be through an analog means.
Yeah. Very good. Well, thank you, Oscar. I think this is a good moment to see if there are any questions you'd like to put to Oscar. Yes, sure.
I'd like to understand, you know, we are living obviously a flattening of the culture across the world, and whether, you know, receiving canvas from all over the world, if that was expressed in some sort of chromatism or different chromatism for different areas of the world, or if you've been able to, because I can see that some of them are quite monochrome, and some of them are full of color. So do they correspond to, you know, part of the geography of the, you know, across the world?
I mean, that corresponds to austerity, maybe like to an austerity of material, to the fact that, you know, certain schools or certain countries just worked with a pen or a pencil or a pen and a pencil and that was it. Or, you know, other countries just had this, you know, pencil case full of felt tips and an abundance of material and were very comfortable with, you know, engaging with them. And I think, you know, in a lot of ways, you know, like a lot of the canvases are in some kind of a very basic, stereotypical, cliched ideas as to what do we expect for certain cultures or certain parts. It throws back that in that same kind of cliched assumption, you know, like Singapore, you know, a lot of the canvases, they were so sterile or austere, because, you know, Singapore is a, you know, it's this new country that, you know, set about creating a certain social order for itself. Or you can say the same thing for, you know, a place like Kisii in Kenya, where it has this beautiful, you know, earthy yellow patina, and then you start to think, well, were there any windows there? You know, was the floor just full of soil? And it's just, you know, like a pencil or a pen that was used. And then you start thinking of like primitivism and just basic means of making, or like Tokyo, which in some schools we were told that, you know, nobody uses a pen here. We have iPads, and that actually, do you want to use, do we want to participate, but can you create a kind of wallet for the iPad so that, you know, maybe through that idea we can participate in this performative project. So I think it's more the you know, like, or India that was full of energy and full of depth and in a way magic and intensity, and a place like Mumbai that is, you know, intensely populated. So I think a lot of, you know, what you see is that, it's that kind of, in a way, information about, you know, how, what the country is or what the city is. Again, this idea of, you know, frequencies from a, you know, social and geopolitical perspective.
Yeah, sorry, just to complete my idea. I thought that maybe, you know, as all the ancient cultures, they drew their, you know, gardens, and somehow, you know, you can see the, associate, you know, vibrant colors across the hottest climates, and maybe more monochrome, you know, to see the coldest.
So is it more monochrome, the Icelandic ones?
Well, I think, you know, I think it's more monochrome where there's more austerity. When kids just have very, you know, a limited amount of equipment, you know, that's really where the monochromatics, you know, I mean, the Italians were very colorful. Or, you know, in Tokyo also, they were very poppy, you know, this kind of like pop culture. I mean, what else? I think, you know, yeah, I think, you know, that kind of, in terms of, again, frequency, you know, this idea, like, geographically speaking, you know, if we're talking about, like, how, you know, if we assume that, you know, in the tropics or, no, I mean, like, we have a place like, you know, again, if we look at the map to give us a geographical lesson, you know, a geography lesson, I mean, Kenya was very basic because precisely this idea of, you know, austerity of material.
Poverty of material.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you, Oscar. Yeah, the question up there. Yeah, you get that freedom moment for you.
One of the things I think is so interesting is that you didn't call it traces, for example, which might have felt like a more obvious title because they are traces, but you call it frequencies, and you've been using that term throughout this discussion. And frequencies, and I just looked it up to try and get my head around again, but certainly my generation, it's around, still is, I suppose, radio frequencies. Mm. And I think it's such an interesting title because it's not very easy to pin down. It's kind of a sort of in the kind of ether. And again, for some of us of a certain generation, one has memories of turning the dial on a radio and seeing a little red line sort of shooting across the capitals of the world. Different radio frequencies is one of the most obvious connections to the word frequency. So I was interested in this title that seems to me to somehow explode beyond the material fact of these extraordinary objects and kind of deliberately giving it a title that sort of, yeah, kind of goes beyond the material. It seems to me really important.
Yeah, no, that's such a great kind of analysis. I mean, I think it was also because a lot of the projects or titles or there is this tremendous awareness of, I mean, we started our conversation when I was in Tokyo and you were, you know, this idea of like movement, you know, it's always very, and that, you know, I also began this awareness of the world by my father leaving Colombia and telling me he was coming here. And then I looked at the map and I just see this small island, you know, in the middle of nowhere. And I'm like, you know, where is that? And I think, you know, this constant, I think from a very early age, there's been a tremendous awareness of just distance and the world and places. And I think this project started out of that more than, I think it started conceptually and of course, I think materially was taken for granted. Like I took it for granted because, you know, I am such a materialist. So I was not so kind of fixated in its material relation. And I was more interested in that, you know, the radio idea of what frequencies, the idea of the frequency in the context of a radio and, the, you know, trying to tune in.
What are we tuning into? Sound, which is much more difficult to pin down.
Exactly.
Thank you. Yeah. Could you wait a moment while we get the pick up your sound? Okay, very good, thank you.
No, there was a moment, and Clara can maybe give you more details about this, but there was a moment in a school in Munich, wasn't there, where a child drew a swastika. And I think that the teachers became very concerned. But we said, you know, we said that we actually like that because it kind of allows for this idea of, okay, let's talk about this, you know, let's, right? That was what? No, so it started very casually, as in the context of growth, it started very casually. It remained it very casually, but the premise was that we would approach whichever school was interested. We ideally asked that every classroom in the school took part. So it wasn't just about art, it was about every, you know, class, you know, English or science or, you know, whatever. And that we discussed the project with the school children. There were no instructions given. The only instruction, I guess, would be that this is a space that you can engage with as you wish to engage with. Throughout 6 months, and then of course, as the kids would leave that day, we would come in the evening, and then we would upholster the desks with a staple gun, and we left them there for 6 months, and that was really the only interaction that took place with the children in the schools. Well, I mean, there are some, you know, strong differences. I think that there are countries that are very, we could say, distinct in their kind of culture. I think that comes through places like India, China. I think those, I would say, are like the most kind of telling of strong difference. You know, maybe Clara, I don't know if Clara, you have any other, but. Then what we have is this homogenized reality, you know, that it's, of course, you know, that comes with different flavors, and of course there are, when you go to the, you know, the canvases in Latin American countries, of course, you see, you know, Spanish come through, and all countries in, you know, in the Middle East and so on. But it, generally speaking, and Nepal also marks a little bit of a difference. But I think generally, there is a kind of manifestation of a homogenized culture that, in a way, reflects social media, maybe, perhaps.
I mean, there's probably true to say that it would be very hard now to find something which was, let's say, a purely local mind.
Yeah.
I mean, you'd have to work very hard. I mean, there would be pockets around the world which, if you like, say, relatively unaffected by, this homogenized global culture, but it's very rare now.
Well, in China.
And the archive, is that because of control of what?
I think because of just how, yeah, China and India, right? I think, you know, and even then, of course, we're still waiting on a lot of the canvases from India because of the pandemic. We were kind of, but I think, I mean, I don't know if Clara has anything else to add, but I would say that China and India were the most distinctive. But I think even like in the schools that, I mean, there was a relationship to sports, you know, like kids being aware of like the Premier League, you know, or like just football in the West, you know, like you know, PSG in Paris or, you know, Man United, you know, there's like, I think even like with the basic idea of just having a television, you know, there is awareness of like, of like culture elsewhere, very strongly, and sports is, you know, football really, it's one that in those places that you think are, you know, kind of removed, you know, they're still like, it managed to get there. And I think China perhaps because of state control, you know, the there's a lot of this kind of nationalistic, you know, like manifestation in a lot of the canvases.
Just to pick up on what you said in terms of like the local, you know, the local, I think that also the project is very much about kind of different local realities connecting to this idea of, you know, kind of collaboration beyond the local. So even in situations where, you know, the worldwide kind of removed environment, narrative of being participating in a project that was connecting different geographies was actually quite exciting at the beginning. So kind of, you know, the kind of motif of flats happens a lot because there is an element of representation.
Because you think because they're conscious, you've explained they are part of a global project, yeah. Right. Any more? Yes, question here.
This is part of a program that we're kind of incorporating as part of the exhibition, where we've invited, it's every week, right?
Every week, a different selector is first given, you know, quite a large digital file to have a look through, and then to make a selection, and then to come and arrange it here. So this selection was made by a really remarkable woman called Andrea Zafaraku, who came to global prominence because in 2018 she won called the Global Teacher Prize, and she teaches art at a secondary school in Brent. So we asked Andrea to come and share her view of the archive. You know, I mean, the incredible thing is there are really as many selections as there could be people to bring to bear on this. It would never be the same. And then next week it will change again. I think next week there are students from the school here who are making them. Then the week after it's a coder, Jasmine.
Yeah, she's a programmer.
Programmer. Then a musician called Nikizi, and then rounding off with the writer and psychotherapist Adam Phillips, who's, so each week be a different selection, and they'll also, that will kind of build up on the website. I mean, in a way, Frequencies just is an ongoing project. You know, it's not going to stop. It's just entering a new phase, which is new phase.
Yeah.
Which is very, very, very exciting, and it's kind of, you know, we're probably not very good at projecting ourselves into the future, but you can imagine 20, 30 years from now, still a live project, that actually a lot of the references won't be very meaningful to people anymore. Although people think, well, why is One Direction being written all over? What does that mean? is that a political movement?
Yeah, sadly.
The things that will be constant will be the names, you know.
Yeah.
Maria or, you know, John or whatever. yes, question here.
I mean, obviously we all have our own observations about what we're looking at. But I think picking up what that gentleman said about, you know, what was in school, you know, when he was a child, this all feels so familiar to me. I mean, it doesn't encapsulate the last 10 years for me. It encapsulates, you know, it shows you how, for me, how much our parents and our grandparents and our histories are in all of this. Because in some ways it feels much more timeless. Hmm. It doesn't, you know, I was at school at say 50 years ago, and it feels like this, my friends have done this. You know, my childhood friends.
Hmm.
I feel there's so many images that I've drawn myself, in that sense, I'm surprised it isn't more technical or somehow we all, these marks, that these human marks that we make, whether it's a flower or a square or a symbol, or that was just an or a graphic. It feels, or it's no man. We're looking at behind us. That is the same one that was there 50 years ago.
Thank you. That's very interesting. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Sorry, I was going to say exactly the opposite.
There are many ways into this archive.
well, what I was going to say is that's actually the fact that it's done in this decade. Holds some relation to that decade in particular. That maybe, you know, in two decades more, this work would be more homogeneous because of the, as I said before, the culture is getting flattened by the, you know, the branding and by the, universal sort of culture and all that. But this is like cut in the time, and it showed that actually is unique because it was done in that precise time, that precise century, and so. Yeah. Sorry.
Thank you. No, we're all for divergent views. So.
Yeah.
Right. One last chance for questions. Go on.
The archive and the way you practice
Yeah, I mean, I think it was definitely. We can't, because we're reminded. I mean, we're in a hall, a sports hall. That's for sure. You know, we can say it's a school or not, but it's definitely a sports hall, and the space kind of dictated a lot. And I think the time that we're in now, and I think the fact that then if we consciously say we are in a school and that frequencies comes out of that and that is heavily engaged in that, and that if the school is this space of indoctrination that where, you know, you enter. And that because of this moment of uncertainty as far as the pandemic is concerned, where the way education might be delivered and engaged with going forward, all of those things then inform, you know, a lot of the decisions. And the fact also that we're in a part of London that is, impoverished, and that, you know, I have a personal relationship with this region, this part of the city, because I grew up here. So all those things are part of the, and also the, you know, this arena here that, of course, it functions perfectly for now, but also, even when the exhibition is just on, that I want to create this kind of leisurely space of contemplation. In a way that all those ideas inform the kind of decision that took place to get to where we are. And in a way, if you can read the archive as the spine, so in a way, I saw the archives just as the spine, that then everything kind of breaks away from it. You know, the idea that you enter from there, but then there's this kind of like column, which is the archive, and then all these other things kind of begin to happen. You know, with the basketball hoops and so on. So that's how I kind of conceptualize the space. Yeah.
So what's going on with the golden basketballs?
My cousin studied here, so he enthusiastically like took me to these cabinets, you know, and showed me, you know, all these trophies, and he said, you know, I was involved in this, and you know, we won this because I was involved here. And I think he just reminded me of this idea of like sports and aspiration, you know. And I think that has been, I think, you know, an artist like David Hammons has, you know, has done the ultimate work of art, you know, this idea of higher goals, you know, which is kind of, you know, he's playing with words, this idea that, you know, like kids from, I don't want to just say, you know, Afro-descendant, but I think generally kids from disadvantaged, you know, backgrounds is either, you know, sports in football or basketball or boxing. You know, those are the, you know, like the Irish, for example, you know, boxing is such a big thing, and football. Or the north of England too, you know, like sports is such a community thing, yeah, because it's connected to the working classes and so on. Or it was connected to, you know, historically speaking. So the fact that it was already here, it just was a great opportunity to engage with that kind of reality.
Great, thank you. Well, thank you, Oscar.
Thank you, James.
For sharing the
thank
island.
You.
Thank you all for the great questions. And please come back and enjoy being shown through some of the canvases. Thanks very much, Oscar.
Thank you.